All right, the creme de la creme, as our very own Brian Lawton called him.
I didn't know Brian Lawton spoke French.
A little bit.
Who knew that? Who knew that?
We find a lot of things out about Lawton. But we're going to find a whole lot more about Mark Stone and his fit now in Vegas as he joins us on his off day on the phone right now. Mark, congratulations on the fit so far and the contract extension there as a Golden Knight. Almost 2 weeks now since your move from Ottawa to Vegas. How's life been, both on and off the ice for you?
Oh, it's been awesome so far. There's a bit of an adjustment, not just moving to a different team, but moving to a different style city. But everything here is first class. It's been unbelievable so far.
Mark, it's Dave Reed here. Congratulations on the new contract and the move to Vegas. Now, you're coming from a team that the playoffs weren't in the picture this year to a team that are focused on the playoffs. Since you've been there, this team really seems to have refocused. Do you feel, you weren't there in the past, but do you feel that there's a real focus to get past where this team went last year in the Stanley Cup final?
Yeah, I mean, right when I got here, I think they're going through a bit of a tough stretch. And from the second I walked in that locker room, the guys were focused on winning hockey games and trying to make sure that we can increase our spot in the standings. And the five games that I've played, the team that we have has the ability to take over and dominate games.
Mark, having come over, I think you're five games into, kind of your tenure as a Vegas Golden Knight. Probably not your first test of Pacific Division hockey, but a pretty scrappy contest versus the Flames last night. You guys come out on top. Your impressions of the Pacific Division rivalry so far? What's life like in the Pacific?
It's definitely different. The Western Conference is a little different hockey, but that game last night was awesome. It was so much fun to be a part of. We got some timely goals. We got some timely saves. And the guys are sticking up for each other throughout the entire night. You're kind of seeing that as I, grow with this team. You kind of see that these guys really care about one another, and I'm so excited to be a part of that.
Speaking of impressions, this is the first time we've had a chance to chat with you since the deadline acquisition. I got to ask you about the arrival at McCarran International Airport there in Vegas. Not everybody who flies into that town gets that kind of reception. Did you know that was coming? And if you didn't, what were your expectations and your first impressions of seeing the hoopla that they rolled out for you?
I think you can tell by my hair and my face, I was not ready to be on camera. So, I was completely surprised, completely shocked. And I was really impressive. So many people from the staff of the Knights was there to welcome me, which, I wasn't expecting. I was kind of just expecting a driver to be there to pick me up. So, for them to do that for me was awesome. I was excited to get into Vegas.
Hey, Mark, I like what Max Pacioretty, your new line mate, talked about when you came into the first scrum. He thought he was going to put his hands up to protect himself. This is your first move to a different team, different organization, some new teammates. How has that been, and how is it playing with Max Pacioretty on your side? Because you guys were in a pretty heated rivalry for years with Ottawa and Montreal.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, we went through two playoff series against each other, play each other four times, and those games are always so physical, so scrappy. So, your life can change so quickly, and for me, it changed in 20 minutes with the trade. So, I was excited. I mean, and right when I walked in the locker room, I saw that he was going to be playing left wing with me and Skasny. It was kind of shocking. It kind of blinked twice to actually believe that you were on a team with Max Pacioretty after all the battles you went through. But I think everybody says it in hockey. There's so many good people in hockey, no matter how fierce the battles are on the ice. Mostly every guy who plays the National Hockey League is a good person.
You know, Mark, you mentioned life in the West, and I'm a player as well that kind of spent a little time in the East, spent a little time in the West. You almost get a sense, you know, the contrast can be so sharp that it's almost like playing in a different league. Your experience so far, what are some of the, you know, just in a quick sense, what are some of the differences between life out East, life out West, just in terms of the style of play, the travel?
Yeah, I mean, the travel is definitely one thing. We've only had one road game since I've been here, and it was just a quick trip to Anaheim. But, you know, tomorrow we're heading out to Vancouver. It's a 2 or 3 hour flight, which is a lot different for me. But, you know, it just takes a little bit of time. You know, I think right now the way the West is so clogged up, there's still so many teams that can get into the playoff picture that games are so tight, whereas I think maybe in the East, I was on one of those teams that was bottom of the standings. The games don't mean as much. I think right now, the way the West is shaping up, these games, they mean so much. Every game, you know, can make or break somebody's season. So there's been some tight games since I've been here.
Yeah, and after what we saw last night, there's a lot of us out there rooting for a first-round matchup between you guys and the Flames and Evander Holyfield, a.k.a. Marc-Andre Fleury. Mark, we won't keep you any longer. Appreciate the time on your off day. Good luck the rest of the season.
No problem, guys. Thank you.
Braden Schenn scoring a goal after missing six games from injury, comes back and gets the first goal of the game for St. Louis. And it's a trend you're starting to see this season as far as the redirection goals, guys in motion as opposed to just static.
Well, it's that net front guy, Jamal, and that's where I've kind of we got Braden Schenn here. First game back into the mix, and there's an interesting look from him. And this, too, remember, a power play situation for the St. Louis Blues. But keep your eyes on Schenn. I call it the rolling or the moving screen. But he's going to take the eyes away of the opposition netminder. It's Gibson in this case. He's moving by kind of in a slow, methodical pace. And the trick about that is, rather than being stationary in one situation or the other, by being stationary, you allow the netminder a look on either side of you. The trouble is, when you're moving, it's kind of like you block out, you eclipse the puck if you can time it for the right moment. And it's almost impossible for a goaltender, given that you're kind of rolling in front of them at that specific moment when the shot's on its way, there's no way to adjust. It's kind of a split-second play. And again, a guy like Schenn seems to have really timed it well. Other guys around the league, you're seeing Arvidsson do this with good success. Wayne Simmonds is kind of doing that rolling screen from time to time. But it adds a layer of difficulty, I think, for the netminder when you can time that screen with the arrival of the puck as opposed to just being there stationary.
Yeah, I agree. It's like if you go play catch and you have somebody walking back and forth or you're whatever you're doing, if you're looking at something coming at you and all of a sudden you don't expect it, it's blocked out for a split second.
Yeah.
You have to refind it.
Yeah.
And that's the difficult thing of the moving screen. And I think it's a lot more difficult for the goaltenders. And and we've seen it. Certain players, like I said, like to do it a little more than others. Other guys just still want to just stand there.
Yeah.
But if you can do that, the goaltender is not really sure, are you coming in front of me? Or are you going to try to deflect it? And even if the goaltender can't see or knows you're there, he can't time and he can't know when to look around you.
Right.
And that's the toughest thing.
That's difficult.
Because the goaltender sees it coming.
Yeah.
And then if you can deflect it, well, good luck.
Yeah. Which is what happened in the Schenn case.
Yeah, which is incredible.
I mean, it's the rolling screen.
Tarasenko's shooting it.
At another layer. Like, he got a piece of it as it goes by.
A Tarasenko shot. Like, try to get a Tarasenko shot standing still, let alone jumping. And he just didn't. He jumped. And he actually did it on Ryan O'Reilly's goal later in the game. It was a power play goal. O'Reilly, perfect shot, but the same thing. With Schenn in front of the net, as he jumps, he didn't need to deflect out. But it's so difficult for a goaltender. It's easy for a goaltender, no matter how big you are, the goaltender can lean one way. I can look around you here.
When you're stationary, he gets an option. I can look on either side of
but
you.
But when you're moving,
you take it away. You take
the
option.
The goaltender has to wait and see, okay, you're going to go by me. And it's tough. If you're trying to catch something or follow something and something slides in front of it, to re-pick it up or readjust is difficult. Yeah. And Braden Schenn, he looked good.
Let's take a look at Columbus as the projected lineup heading into tonight. And you look at some of the newer names that this team acquired at the deadline, maybe most notably a guy like Matt Duchene. How have the new guys, Reader, fit in from your perspective so far?
Well, Duchene had a pretty good start, a couple points after two games, but I think he's struggled a little bit since then to find the offensive game. And it's similar to what I saw when he went to Ottawa. And he's obviously the big key in all of the acquisitions. And when he went to Ottawa, he really took a time to find his game, to find a teammate. And when he got together with Mike Hoffman, a shooter, just a sniper, Duchene's game just took off. And that's what I think they've got to find. They've got to find a fit with Duchene, get a sniper, get a guy who thinks the game the same way. Allow Matt Duchene to work the corners. He loves to work the puck low, loves the short give and goes, and he can find the open man under pressure. That hasn't been quite the case so far in Columbus, and that's not something that Columbus wants to hear. Columbus wants to get Matt Duchene integrated quickly into the lineup, find his offensive game, because he was rolling along. Even on a weak team in Ottawa, he was still rolling along in points.
Yeah.
So that, to me, is the biggest problem. Ryan Dzingel is an excellent skater, can move up and down the lineup, can play in a first, can play in a fourth line, but Matt Duchene, to me, is the guy that they've got to find someone to play with, and they've got to find it quickly because it's also about confidence when you talk about Matt Duchene.
Stu, how do you balance that if you're a coach, as far as you're running out of runway here between now and the playoffs, yet how long of the leash do you give a guy time to find that chemistry before you maybe say, all right, this isn't working, I'm doing something else?
That's exactly the question. It's exactly the concern. Because you have such a limited now amount of runway, those choices, those options to kind of try a guy here and there, you're inclined at this stage of the year, post-deadline, to give it a little less time, whereby you might have given it a three-game block, a four-game block, to kind of figure out, has this group got that kind of chemistry you reference? Reader, now I think you're looking at a game two at the most to try to find some chemistry. Ryan Dzingel, clearly not going to get the kind of bounce from him potentially that you'll get from a Duchene, but this is a 20-goal guy working on his second back-to-back 20-goal season. His next shot on net matches a career high. You want to find some space for this guy above the fourth line, in my estimation, his current station where the Columbus Blue Jackets are concerned, to get maximum depth scoring out of this group. And I don't know if Dzingel necessarily fits where you would hope he would post-deadline as you work towards the playoffs.
I really think you've got to go back to your number one line. You got to leave your number one line together, and then you've got to find a fit for the other players.
Yeah.
And by moving Dubois, by switching that up and trying to put Duchene right in the middle with Panarin and Atkinson, and moving Pierre-Luc Dubois down and around, that was a really good line in Columbus. They were scoring. And the big thing was that Boone Jenner was now going to be able to play the wing. Well, we see him at center. Boone Jenner is not a center. He doesn't have the foot speed. He is an excellent winger to get in hard in the forecheck, create some space, work the low corners, work the front of the net. I'm not really sure this constant line juggling is what's going to work in Columbus. I know it's the way that most coaches work. I know it's the way that Trotz always likes doing things. This is a team that I think really needs to find a way. Just put Matt Duchene in a situation. Yeah. Go figure it out. He's too good a hockey player to just keep, this might work this game. This might work after this period. Here's your guys. Mm-hmm. You guys go figure it out, because we've got our number one line. We're rolling. We need to win hockey games.
All right, so you mentioned winning hockey games. This may be one of the biggest ones we see down the stretch. Are you surprised at the goaltending choice tonight? Jonas Korpisalo getting the start. Keith Kincaid as the backup. So Bob is looking from the ninth floor down tonight.
Yeah, I mean, position A, if you're the Columbus Blue Jackets, you want your proven number one in this spot at this moment. I don't know that there are points, matchups more critical than this stretch of hockey for the Columbus Blue Jackets right at this moment. So that Bob is not part of the equation, I would say that's a little bit concerning. And Kincaid too, you go out of your way to acquire Kincaid coming into the deadline. Maybe there's an expectation, given his career numbers versus the Penguins, he gets this start here tonight, front end of a home and home with the Pens. It's a little bit surprising, and I guess it's Korpisalo's ball to run with, and hopefully for the Blue Jackets' sake, he runs and executes well. But I think we're in a bit of a tailspin here if that doesn't result in a victory here in the early going in this back-to-back matchup.
It's kind of like their whole approach at the trade deadline. Like, if it works, we're not questioning it.
Yeah.
If it doesn't, then we'll all be Monday morning quarterbacks.
There's a lot riding on it, JMO. And I'll tell you what, you know, put a little context on this too. We're talking about a back-to-back set versus the Penguins. Somebody you're in direct competition for one of those wildcard spots on the Eastern side. Mm-hmm. On the tail end of that, you're going into a series of five games that are versus playoff teams. So it's an important sector of hockey for these Columbus Blue Jackets. And you almost look at that seven-game block going, if they come out the other side and they've got a spot, you like their chances. If they're 4 points south of the line, has that block, has that sector of games kind of dictated their fate, failing to qualify for the postseason?
And having a three-headed monster in practice, three goalies, just doesn't work.
Oh, it's ugly.
I'm sorry.
Yeah. I mean, you can Calgary, ask on Long Island.
Yeah.
We've seen
you can ask the goaltenders. Yeah. It just creates tension and friction around not only the goaltenders, around everybody. Because if you're everybody's friends with the guys on the team, and you bring in the third goalie, and this is nothing against Keith Kincaid because he's a fantastic person. He's a National Hockey League goaltender. But you put him in a situation where now it's just an odd situation because every goaltender wants their net in practice, and they want to stay in the net the whole practice. They don't want to go sit in the bench and get in the way or stand in the middle of the lineup when you're doing drills. It's like it just doesn't work. So
it's a simple thing, but it throws the entire culture, the vibe right out of whack. Yeah, it really does. It sends a tremor through the entire roster.
Bobrovsky hasn't played that well. In his last 25 games, he's given up three or more goals 17 times in 25 games. That's not very good. The other eight games, he had four shutouts. So he's either really good or the team has to score four goals to win. Scoring four goals to win, doesn't seem like it. Well, it is a lot. Because it doesn't
happen. It's a lot at this time of year.
It's usually 3.2, 3.3, maybe 3.5 if you're really good. But to score four goals on a consistent basis in 17 of 25 games, it's going to be difficult. So by leaving him in the stands, I'm not really sure is going to help. And Kincaid's got a great record against Pittsburgh. I thought that was kind of part of the reason they might have wanted to bring him in. We've got to beat Pitt. This is a great opportunity to put him in. And he's sitting on the bench, so it's interesting. But getting back to the schedule, there's two games against Pitt, there's two games against Carolina, and one game against Montreal.
Yeah.
If Columbus wants to make the playoffs, they have to win all five of those games, in my mind, in regulation without giving up a point. That gives them a really good look. I know you're looking at it in the seven game, but I looked at those games. Those are the teams you were in direct competition with. If you split those, that's it. They're in a tough time.
Two teams playing well with all kinds of urgency, desperation in the camp. Yep. They've got a lot to play for.
Sixth hardest schedule out of all 31 teams remaining.
It's not ideal.
NHL.
Please. 2-2 to score. Let me ask you guys a quick question, if I may. The identity of the Islanders has been what a turnaround defensively, from most goals allowed last year to this year. They have given up three or more goals in the last several games, and here they've given up two to Ottawa. This is the back end of a home-and-home. Is there any concern in terms of your look at this club slippage at this stage of the season?
Yeah, it's kind of peculiar. You don't expect them to run through the entire season. Coming into the season, who would have thought the Islanders would be where they are at this point? You wouldn't necessarily think so. So they've exceeded expectations, but they've done it, and they've done this well on the premise of defending well. And that's what they've done.
That's
they've played
identity.
Team hockey. That's their identity. But if you look at their split here in the last 10 games, they're 5-4-1, and you're right. The defensive details of the game have gotten away from them. Now, I love that Coach Trotz, knowing him the way we do, he's been chill. He doesn't say anything publicly about it, but you have to think that between him and Lou Lamoriello, they're having the meetings to say, guys, we got to start tightening the screws here and get back to what's made us this successful.
Right.
Because as you pointed out, the Washington Capitals have hit their gear. The Pittsburgh Penguins are playing better. It's not going to get any easier as they continue to pursue that playoff spot.
My concern with them, and it has been all year, is I've loved what they've done. I think they're coached very well, and they have that identity we always talk about, and you just spoke to that. But do they have another level? Mm-hmm. And that was a concern of mine, that they've won games. Winning games in the regular season that look a certain way is one thing. But to win them in this part of the season, the second half of the season, and in the playoffs, they look and feel completely different. Do they have that another level to get it to? I don't know. That's my only concern with them, because they don't necessarily have the star power, because they're by committee type team, which is great. But they don't have that star power who's going to be like, tonight, this is my game, guys. I got this one, you know? Mm-hmm. And that's a concern of mine, because I think you do need that come playoff time. So we'll see if they can tighten it up, because if it's not defense, it's not happening with this team, and that's what they have to get back to.
Yeah. Completely agree with that.
Your point about star power, this won't be popular on Long Island, but the last time they were in the playoffs, that 91 guy was a horse.
No doubt.
And that's important come playoff time when, Weeksyism, the rink shrinks.
The rink shrinks, yeah. Rupper makes great points. Both of you guys, you need a game breaker at times. You need somebody to grab a game by the throat and make plays and be able to generate something, especially when nothing's there. Yeah. That's tough for them right now because one of the things, the byproducts of their good defense is where you see them now in the standings. So they've gotten there based on that defensive structure that they have and the commitment to it. One of the other sides of that is Matt Barzell's production is a little bit down off last year. We finished as an 85-point
yes.
guy. Yeah.
Calder.
Calder. But I'll tell you one thing. The team's winning. It's a better team overall. So he feels, you know, he can maybe sacrifice some of his production for the team playing better. But I'd like to see him become a little unleashed mm-hmm. as we go forward at times. Use that speed. It's lethal.
There, we remember over the last month or two, I remember looking and paying attention to some of these games where you look and you're like, the Islanders only had 15 shots on goal in right. this game, or the Islanders, you know, only had this. You can get by with that because you play good sound defense, but if any of that slips, you're in trouble. Yeah. And so that way they think that they're fragile. We talk about the good teams. I'm not saying the Islanders aren't a good team. The highly skilled teams mm-hmm. that have the offensive power. Yeah, they can win if you allow them to play their way. Well, it's the same thing on the other side of the coin now, because if they play defensive sound hockey, they have a great chance of winning. But if it's anything that deters from that, they're done. And that's my concern with them. I just don't know if they have another level. They can win games other ways. They're still in a good spot right now, but they got some work to do.
We always talk about scoreboard watching, but what Rupper just did is something all of you guys do also, and that's schedule watching.
Yeah.
When you were breaking that down earlier, please explain what you're looking for as you're looking at the schedule ahead.
Well, I mean, there's no easy games. We know this, and we see this on tonight's schedule and every night at this time of year. Even those teams that are out of the playoffs, they can keep you sleeping a little bit. But you still would like to have the easier of the schedules, and when you're looking at it, with the remaining 15-ish games for the Minnesota Wild, and my projections with teams that are in the hunt, mm-hmm. like a point out of the playoffs, or teams that are in the playoffs, they've got 13 of their last 15 against teams like that.
That's tough.
And Colorado Avalanche, on the other hand, and some of those other teams that are trying to get in, that are right in that same realm of the Minnesota Wild, are looking at like 6 against teams like that. So it's tough.
Yeah.
So this is huge because Tampa Bay is obviously one of those 13 for the Wild. And they've been playing pretty darn good since the trade deadline, which is surprising because the way that they were kind of sending guys off,
right.
you thought that they were
selling.
Okay with missing and trying to kind of just tweak things moving forward in the future. But you got to give them a lot of credit. This is a big win.
Yeah, huge win. I mean, you go into Tampa, you beat the league's best team.
Yes.
You put up a hattie on them, number mm-hmm. one. So credit to Zucker. So you put the hat trick up on. Doobie with the shutout, which is huge.
Yes. Yeah.
Big, big one. Last game, there's a little bit of panic again, which we don't like seeing. And I know how much, and you know, obviously you're a member of the Wild, but we know how much they live hockey there. But one thing that I'm looking for down the stretch, you talked about the schedule, great point. I want to see if they have the level of calm, because you're going to have to be calm. There's a lot of waves right now. Emotional up and downs coming down the stretch. They need that calmness. They have good pieces. They've got a good team.
When you say
they,
you're referring to a specific area of the bench.
I totally am. I'm referring to head coach Boudreau. He's got to be chill back there. He's
right.
got to be back there and be chill. Push the right buttons. Don't panic. Be calm because they've got a good thing in place there. And obviously, they've got great fans. It's a state of hockey for a reason.
Yeah.
So believe in the game plan. Believe in everybody. Of course, you want to hold guys accountable. But if you get down one or two and you start panicking, especially coming down the stretch, it only compounds the difficulty that you were talking about with that schedule.
Impressive win. This is a statement victory. As you guys point out, the moves that were made around the trade deadline made some think perhaps this is not a year where the Wild have much confidence.
Yeah.
This is a confidence-inspiring
win. And look at some
win.
Of the moves, how they've panned out. You've got Donato, who's been very nice since he's arrived.
Impactful. Can you imagine the Columbus Blue Jackets going all in at the trade deadline and not making the playoffs? A terrifying scenario for a club that's made it back-to-back years, still trying to win their first round in the playoffs. You two, before the night unfolded, news breaking how John Tortorella was going to handle this home-and-home. Front end of it, he decides not to go with Bob in uniform, and you felt strongly about it. Why?
Well, because, listen, I'm sitting there looking to myself. You have a goaltender in Sergei Bobrovsky who has struggled against the Pittsburgh Penguins, but also this team has struggled since they've been in Columbus against the Pittsburgh Penguins. But the Penguins have dominated the situation, this matchup, for the last two seasons. And my problem is this is no knock, no indictment on Jonas Korpisalo. But why would Sergei, give me one reason why Korpisalo shouldn't start this game. I mean, you've got a huge game. You've got a whole, Bobrovsky should start this game.
Yeah.
Why is Korpisalo starting it? You have this team a home and home today, and then you have them on Saturday, okay? So you've got, this could be the season. So all those moves that you made at the deadline saying, we're pushing all of our chips in, you're not starting your two-time Vezina winner? I don't understand it. I don't get it. There's nothing that makes sense to me in this. And even if they won this game, you can't lose Sergei Bobrovsky. Because the way you make these moves, it's not to win a series. It's to go deep on a run. This team will not go on a run. And again, no indictment to Keith Kincaid or Jonas Korpisalo. They will not go on a run unless Sergei Bobrovsky's in net. He's the only one that will take them multiple rounds. You're going to lose him. If you haven't lost him already this year, you're losing him with this decision. I don't get it. I don't understand it. If you need this goalie to get his way out of it to feel good against the Pittsburgh Penguins, you don't shelter him from the Pittsburgh Penguins. He has to play in this game on Saturday now, and he's got one game now before the playoffs where they could meet up. I don't understand it. I don't get it.
And then these numbers. You guys pointed this out in the meeting.
If one was to start, it's Keith Kincaid. Keith Kincaid has dominated when he was in Jersey, the Pittsburgh Penguins, as the Devils have dominated the Penguins the last two seasons. I just don't understand in any way. And you can also hear maybe the decision is, well, we're in the now. We have to make the playoffs. I'm not thinking that far down. So you're telling me that your message to your team and your starting goaltender, Sergei Bobrovsky, is your message is the best way for us to win today is with you in the stands? I don't understand it, man. I really don't. I don't know the logic behind it, but it doesn't make sense to me. Nothing matches up as far as what the team has done deadline time to go for a run in this decision on your goaltending.
Yeah, I mean, that's great points, Rupper. I mean, those are hard to argue.
He played the position. Yeah. And yet he's this fired up. I can only imagine what you're thinking.
Well, listen, I was fortunate in a sense to play with a lot of Hall of Fame guys and guys that are close to being Hall of Fame goalies. And no matter how well I was playing, if we were coming down the stretch, I wasn't playing ahead of those guys. So be it Lundqvist, be it Habib Bulin. I mean, you can go up at Marty. I mean, we can go up and down the list. They usually go with their ace. When you're playing with an ace, you usually go with that ace. So I coming into this game, I figured Bobrovsky would have been starting. I didn't even think it was a thing when we got here today. But I don't know. I don't understand the logic in the decision because you make a lot of great points there.
It's comparable if you're sitting there and – say I'm on the Pittsburgh Penguins, I need to make the playoffs. Our team needs to make the playoffs. Mike Grubb is a fourth-line center. Evgeny Malkin, or say Sidney Crosby is the top-line center, which he is on that team. When you look at the situation, it would be like, listen, Sid has been struggling lately. Rupper, we're going to move you up to the first line in a must-win game. Yeah. Sid, take the night off. I mean, it's insane to think that way. That is what's going on in this situation. I don't understand it. This team is not going to win without Bobrovsky in net. That's why you kept him, is it not?
Yeah.
I mean, if you don't feel that way and you weren't all in and picking up Matt Duchene and DeZingle and McQuaid and doing all these things, nothing makes sense to me. So now you have to put him in here on Saturday. I can't imagine him not putting
There's
him in
no
on
way
Saturday.
He doesn't go Saturday.
I can't imagine. I mean, unless you're going to go Keith Kincaid.
Go tonight.
How about that?
I thought, when we got here, I thought he was going. So I don't know. It's just let's look at it from a football standpoint. From a football standpoint, if that's the Steelers, Roethlisberger's playing, no? Right? You start going around. If it's KC, it's Patrick Mahomes. Right? So Tom Brady, if it's New England. I mean, we know all the names. So it's really no different at the quarterback or the goalie position. Unless there's something that happened. I don't know. Maybe he's dinged up. But if he's not dinged up, I'm with you. You got to go with your best. In the big spots, you want to go with your best, give your team the best chance to win.
Last thing for you. He said you don't want to lose him emotionally. We know how good Bob is. Is it possible that he could be lost already based on all the drama we've heard that's unfolded there?
I think the biggest thing that people forget sometimes is that we're in the people business too. So it's not the X's and O's. It's not the technical elements only. It's not your reflexes, your reads, your angles, power play, penalty kill, scoring chances. at the root of all that, it's people. So that's a big part of it. So the players have emotions too. They're people.
Yeah.
And they're not robots.
Yeah.
And, you know, it doesn't matter who it is. I mean, we've countless players that we've played with. Vinny LeCavalier, Brad Richards, who, I mean, we could go Henrik Lundqvist. They've got, and now Jonathan Quick, people have emotions too. So that's a big part of it. People don't talk about that, but that's a huge part of being right and feeling good and feeling of sound mind and feeling calm and feeling balanced to be able to go out and play. And if and or when that's off, all bets are off.
So if you play, and the matchup don't look like it right now, if they play the Pittsburgh Penguins in the playoffs,
well, you tell me.
Who do you go with? Like, that's my thing, is you threw a whole wrench in all of this. You didn't solve anything. Throw Bobrovsky out there.
I'd
then
roll
at the end
Bob's,
of the day,
man.
At least you say, hey, listen, we put our best foot forward.
Yes.
We didn't get the job done in this game. But you don't know. It's a mess. Mm. It's a goaltender. So that the situation went from a personnel mess, not knowing who they're going to have, whatever. Now they're creating a goaltending mess, I believe, in this kind of situation.
That's tough. And then it creates questions. That's the whole thing.
Mm-hmm.
You don't want to create any questions. I think that, again, for the 78th time to everybody in Ohio, I've been saying it all year, and Rupper, you're from there. So more importantly, you played there. This team has nice pieces.
Oh, I love it.
This team has the pieces.
I think that
they've got pieces, but you don't want to add any distractions to the pieces.
That's
Stu
my
Grimson
point.
Was talking about it in our pregame show here today.
That's my point, though, is that when I sit here and I'm looking at it from a fan's point of view, and I'm going to use it, I'm like, part of me is thinking, I'm rooting for this team.
Yeah.
What they did and what Jaromír Kekäläinen
totally.
Did in the tough spot they were in, and they go out and they add.
Bold.
This is what we all want to see in
the
professional
sport. They went
That's
for
true.
It.
So
That's
I want
true.
Them. They've done nothing but create.
Yep. Right.
And listen, Torts has created a culture there, and they've changed the thinking there. So lots of things have been going right. But all of those moves and all those things put in place to move this way, this move is moving this way. Mm-hmm. And that doesn't make sense to me. I don't understand that part. Mm-hmm. So either you're all in or you're not all in. And this was not an all-in move for me by not starting Bobrovsky in this game.
And also the thing is, all of that becomes moot. It's all moot if your tender is not ready to go.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know what I mean?
Yes.
Like everybody always says, your goalie is your most important player. Can't go anywhere without a goalie.
Right.
You need your goalie. No goalie, no game. No goalie, no win. You want to make sure that you keep that rolling in the right direction. So you're right, Ruffer. I don't see how this is in keeping with the direction that they went on by way of trade deadline day. I like the moves. We all talk about the fact that you want teams that are proactive. And a lot of times, let's be fair, people will say years in years past, well, we can't make deals, the salary cap. No. I like that Jarmo went for it.
Oh, it's awesome.
But now you're absolutely right. This is not in alignment with that.
And Matt Murray, by the way, at the other end of the ice, pitched a shutout.
Yes, you're right.
Stay hot.
Tenth career.
Of his career. Got a dunking comeback from two goals down.
McAvoy with the chance. McAvoy back to Grzelcyk, to Marchand, to Grzelcyk. He scores! First goal in 49 games. Off the faceoff, the captain gets it out. Achari can't get through Ekblad. Final 10 seconds. Marchand to Bergeron. He scores! Patrice Bergeron! And the Bruins have come back to beat Florida in the final seconds.
Jack Edwards.
You gotta love that.
Get yourself a lozenge and a tea with some lemon and honey and make sure it's warm water there in Beantown. Stay off the chowder. But that's a big comeback for you Beavs fans up there in the Northeast. Wow. What a turn of events, Rupper.
Seriously.
I mean, unbelievable. If you weren't jacked up for playoff time in Boston with the terror this team's been on, with this kind of game, this kind of comeback, from a guy like Patrice Bergeron getting this goal, this is crazy there in Boston.
This is nuts. My buddy Frankie, big Bruins fans, texted me saying he's emotional.
Emotional?
You guys win at everything. That
they
city
do.
Wins everything.
Patriots, Red Sox.
It's the most historic run in Major League sports history. But on a night like tonight, they show why. Huge win. This team's on fire right now.
And this is what Weeksy's talking about. When we say on fire, we mean 18-game point streak, 14-0-4. And this one, they snatched victory from the jaws of defeat. It looked like they were done. Not only do they tie it, but they earn the win in the dying seconds.
Incredible.
Wow. It's time for us to explore the studio space, gentlemen. We do it all. We got the moving crew. Here we go.
Beep,
push.
Beep, I got the Zamboni.
Yep, we'll be back.
I got the Zamboni.
This is not moving.
You don't know the Zamboni.
Weeksy, watch out for
Audio
the
Audio Joe, get in here. Here
Weeksy,
we go.
Weeksy, watch out for the box right
you
there.
You don't know the Zamboni.
Lloyd.
O-line. Here
Lloyd.
We go. Go, 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 go. Walking sled. Go, 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 go. We had an Enterprise. Hat trick. Gentlemen, when you go into the barn of the Tampa Bay Lightning and you beat them 3-0 and Jason Zucker's the guy who lights the lamp all three times, that gets attention. What about 16 and what he did for the Wild tonight?
You want to raise your game against the best players and the best team. Zucker did exactly that. He was absolutely dominant. Rupper put his fingerprints all over this one. 3-0 win, shutout on the road against the league's best team.
Yeah, it's impressive. A great skater, powerful skater. He's a goal scorer, natural goal scorer. Great to see him at the right time of season. You see right there, last 7 games. This team is fighting for their playoff lives. Their best players need to be their best players. Jason Zucker's one of their best goal scorers, and he's performing.
They have been in the playoffs 6 straight years. 3 straight first round exits. We have a Pepsi Zero Sugar shutout. Anytime you can pitch a shutout in the National League, it's a big deal. But when Devin Dubnyk goes to Tampa and blanks that offense, Weeksy, Rupper, how does that impress you?
In a big way, because it is zero sugar, but there were not zero saves. There were a lot of saves in this one, and he went up against the league's most potent team, the best team in the National, and a huge, those ones feel so good on the road.
Mm-hmm.
Congrats to Doobie. That's a great run right now, and they need him more than ever. Excellent performance by him and his teammates, Rupper.
Yeah, it's incredible. That the timing of it is what's incredible as well. Not only to do it against those things you mentioned, against the one of the greatest offensive teams in the history of our game.
No exaggeration. Yeah. Seriously.
That's what we're talking about. True. So you get that, but the timely manner that this Wild team needs to keep stringing teams together to solidify their chances of staying in the playoff hunt.
Yeah, and let the backbone be the backbone. He certainly was that. He was great. They needed that. When you come in against a top team on the road, Amalie Arena, you know that you're going to be relying upon your goalie. You know that. He's going to be called upon to make big saves, timely saves. And in the end, between him and Zucker and their teammates, they got it done. Massive win for them on the road.
In a clinching scenario, coming into that game, Tampa had the chance to clinch its playoff spot.
Already.
Tonight, it's crazy. Shutout. Head of the goalie union, Kevin Weeks. Matt Murray. How does he look to you as we get ready to head into the spring?
Overall, he looks right. The main thing is that he's healthy. When Matt Murray's on his A game, pucks don't go through him, and he's very positionally sound. But I also like when there's a little desperation in his game, too. Sometimes when you have goalies that are so technically solid the way Matt Murray is and has that height and range, they have a tendency to be a little bit calm and relaxed, but not the case in this one. I like to see when they have a little bite in their game and they compete. Matt Murray was able to do that, not under heavy duress, but not dissimilar to Carey Price. Carey Price, very efficient,
elegant.
Very smooth, very elegant,
elegant
in the net.
I love it.
And sometimes just based on broken plays, deflections, screens, you got to react. So big, big performance for Matt Murray. This is a big win for Pittsburgh Penguins right now with the playoff implications.
Mm-hmm.
And on the other end of it, it's a tough loss for the Jackets.
And they got these. They got this matchup, this home-and-home matchup on Saturday. Yeah, this is one the Blue Jackets needed. They certainly needed it. This helps Pittsburgh immensely, this game. And this thing of Columbus just not having success against the Penguins continues. And they're going to have to get over that. They're going to have to get over that because they got another huge – I mean, this literally could be the season on Saturday night here for the Blue Jackets.
No exaggeration. We always hear four-point game, boys, four-point game. It's two for you and not two for them. Massive night for both these teams. We have a hat trick, and the color scheme is appropriate because it's a team that wears green that benefits. Alex Radulov with a hattie back in a big way for Dallas. What an impact he's making tonight, Rupper and Weeksy.
It's huge. It's
get
huge.
In there, Rupper.
No, that's
get involved.
This game was huge for both teams with the playoff implications on the line. And Radulov's one of those big-time players. His goal total might not be that big. He was banged up a lot, you know, this year and unable to stay healthy. And
But he's one of those guys that his game will translate really, really well to the playoffs. So the biggest thing is getting in. He did his part in this game.
Count Radula back biting again. I love it. Hat trick, atoned for everything, ready to roll, reset. Jim Montgomery's doing a nice job. I'm telling you right now, Jeff Reese, their goalie coach, has got Ben Bishop back on his game.
Yes.
And Anton Khudobin looks great because Ben Bishop was awesome in Tampa. He looks sweet right now once again.
There was a time when it was the same retreads. When coaching hires were made, it was the same names over and over again. Montgomery comes from a college ranks, and I've heard both of you praise his work in his first year making the transition.
Guys love him there. They loved him at University of Denver, won a national championship, won one as a player at University of Maine with Paul Kariya and that stack team. It's a nice hire, Rupper.
It is, and it's not an easy – when you look at some of the guys that have made that jump, it's not generally – easy. It's not an easy job in general,
right.
But he's done a great job. This team's defending, and that's a big reason why they're having some success.
And it was a Pepsi Zero Sugar shutout for Ben Bishop and the Stars. And if they want to remain in the playoff hunt, they're going to need their goalie to be their backbone down the stretch. Well, since the beginning of March, Bish has been just that. He is currently sporting a 124-minute and 40-second shutout streak. And guess what? We have another Pepsi Zero Sugar shutout, this time provided by Darcy Kuemper, who has been on a tear with 8 wins and 2 shutouts over his last 9 games. In that span, he's sporting a 1.53 goals against average. And it was another Pepsi Zero Sugar shutout, this time provided by Jake Allen. He's only played in 4 games in the Blues' last 11 contests, but he has made the most of it with a 2-1-1 record and 2 shutouts in that span.
We are ready to go for the NHL Hat Trick Challenge presented by Enterprise. Weeksy, will the Caps score at least 4 goals against the Devils?
I say yes. Washington has found their game. I had a chance to see them up close Sunday afternoon, and they said, every player to a man that I spoke with, they said the bye week has been beneficial to them. They feel regenerated. They reset, they're ready to go. And you can see the way that they're making plays up and down the lineup, I might add, as well. I think Carl Hagelin was a nice addition, giving them some speed on that fourth line. And Ovi continues to be Ovi, but players like Vrana and also Burakovsky has played very well for them.
And if you get a chance, read Braden Holtby's Players Tribune
great
article.
Piece.
All we do is keep talking about it. So much to like
great
there.
Great piece.
Eric Staal, will he score at least 1 goal?
I'll say yes. Eric Staal is starting to turn his offensive game around. The numbers are down a little bit from last year. But one thing I know about Eric Staal is the bigger the games get, the better he plays.
Mm-hmm.
And we're coming down the stretch now for your Minnesota Wild, for you fans out there in Mini, in and around Brainerd perhaps. But nonetheless, he's got big-time playoff experience, Stanley Cup experience, international experience as well with Team Canada. He's a gamer, so I got to hedge on yes.
Next and last question. Canes, Jets, who wins?
I'm going to go with the Canes on this one. This is the Paul Maurice
Bowl.
And I got to think that the Canes now coming off that tough loss to the Bees, but played very well in that nonetheless. Maybe some lessons learned in that game. You got to keep your foot on the gas pedal. But for the Canes now, the key for them is a 60-minute effort, which they're getting under their really new direction that they're getting from head coach Rod Brind'Amour. But I look for the Canes to come out and not to atone for that loss, but maybe learn some lessons in that loss and play a full 60-minute game or 65 if need be.
There are Weeksy's picks. Play NHL Hat Trick Challenge daily for the chance to win the $20,000 regular season grand prize and until April 6th for your chance to win the $10,000 period 3 prize.
For your 3 stars of the night, 3rd star goes to Matt Murray, who made all 25 saves for his 10th career shutout. In his career, Murray has 8 wins in 10 games against Columbus. 2nd star goes to Alexander Radulov, who scored his first career hat trick on Thursday. He had himself a 5-game point streak now against the Avalanche with 10 points in that span. And your 1st star of the night goes to Jason Zucker, who recorded his 2nd career natural hat trick. Zucker reaches the 20-goal plateau for the 3rd straight season and the 4th time in his career.
Inviting you to an evening of action in the National Hockey League.
I fear he did a great job. Look out, the glass came popping out. From the heavens, we can see Ted Lindsay. Varley's boy has got that all time.
Zucker for the hat trick. He scores!
So far, so good.
That could be dangerous.
Stole about it, took the puck away.
Fans are giving him a hand there.
The sky's the limit.
Bread and butter.
That the building is seventh heaven.
Nobody hotter right now.
You see the poise of some of the fans
about speed, playing this game fast, and scoring a ton of goals.
Picked off by Shin.
He's away with Tarasenko. To the net, Tarasenko shoots. He scores! What a shot by Tarasenko, his 28th, and the Blues take a 1-0 lead.
First goal in his last seven. And this was an absolute rocket.
Here comes Huberdeau charging in against Chara. Huberdeau turns and shoots and scores! Hoobie doobie doo! What a goal by Huberdeau!
That is just a remarkable play by a goal scorer.
Final 10 seconds. Marchand to Bergeron. He scores! Patrice Bergeron!